Come on, give him a little more than that. Hallelujah. We thank you. We glorify you. Come on, say something well of him. Speak well of him. Father, we thank you. We magnify. You say something. I'm saying something. I need you to say something about him. Father, I adore you. Magnify and glorify your name. Thank you for this day, everything you've done. Thank you for bringing us out safely, Lord God. We thank you that you always lavish your love upon us, Lord God. Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just ask you to be present in the midst of the study tonight, Lord God. Father, I pray that Fred would decrease so that you would increase in me, Father. Father, bring forth a teacher on tonight, Lord God. Change, transform, and renew our hearts and our minds, God. Father, help us to receive the warning of your word, Father, that we can walk upright before you, Father. We pray for Bishop in his absence, Lord God. We thank you for everyone that's coming out, for those who are making the journey here even now, Lord God. We declare journey mercies, top to bottom, forwards and backwards, Lord God. We pray safety, travel, and mercy, God. Father, we just thank you for this week and all that you've done for us, Lord God, at work, at school, at home, Father. We thank you for healthy relationships, Lord God. We thank you that our children are blessed, that our marriages are blessed, our homes are blessed, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for you, Father, you're jealous for us, Lord God, and towards us, Lord God, that you care for us, Lord, with an unfailing love, and we thank you. We thank you for those who are watching by live stream through Facebook, Lord God, through YouTube. Father, we pray that you will reach through the airwaves, Lord God, and touch them in a special way. We lift up those who are bedridden, Father. We speak and declare and decree health, Lord God, that you are healing their bodies. We declare that with your stripes they are healed, Father. And we just thank you, Lord God, that we know you, Father. We can call on you in the time of need, for you are present help, Lord God. Now, Father, we put this service into your hand, Lord God. We thank you and we glorify you in Jesus' name, and people of God, clap their hands. Hallelujah. You can take your seats. Well, I've been waiting to get to y'all. I tell you what, I've been waiting to get to y'all. Let me tell you how amazing God is. I prepared a lesson probably about 5 weeks ago. And, you know, you always, me and my minister brothers were talking, and say, we always try to keep one in the chamber. Keep one ready, because you don't know when Bishop's going to call you up, and we always talk about that when we come in. But I try to stay on the ready, especially because we have vision hour. I got a little echo, if we can take that out. And so in my quiet time, God has been speaking to me about the seas and the waves roaring. Amen. When we look into the Word of God, which we're going to do today, we see that we are being forewarned of something that is yet to come. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit today and being ready. We're good to go. Thank you. All right, so we can get started here. I bring you greetings on the behalf of our bishop who is out today. I am Minister Fred Williams, Elder Fred Williams, and we are glad to be here to minister the word to you today. And we'll start right at Luke 21, 25 through 27. When you get it, say amen. Let me kind of set this thing up for you, because some things happened years ago, and I was the thing that I was saying I was so excited about is I was looking and reading the news, and I had already prepared the lesson, as I said, about 5 weeks ago, and when I started looking at the news, I started seeing the things that I was studying on. I still got that echo up here. It's making it kind of difficult for me to hear, but I mean, I can hear myself better than I like to. And I was kept reading about the earthquakes and things to come, and the eclipse, which we know is going to be on April 8th and stuff like that. And I was preparing a lesson for Vision Hour. There's a couple lessons I was preparing, and I brought them to Bishop. One of the lessons was on unusual prophecies being fulfilled. I'm going to say that again. Unusual prophecies being fulfilled. And there's a lot of prophecies in Scripture that we don't really pay that much attention to. But as of late, God's been prompting me, the Holy Spirit's been prompting me to look into these prophecies to see what they're saying, what they're speaking. And, looking at some of my favorite prophecy teachers, they're speaking and saying the same thing. They're saying, if you live on the coast, get off the coast. And this is not to fear monger or anything like that, but just so that we can be aware. God does nothing unless he first reveals it to his prophet, amen. And I'm certainly not saying I'm a prophet. The spirit of prophecy can fall on any believer. Let me say that again. The spirit of prophecy can fall on any believer. It doesn't mean that you're a prophet or a prophetess. It just means at the time that God wants in his, what we call Carol's time, and can speak to you and give you a right now word concerning something that is yet to come. Amen? Now, the office of a prophet is a whole different thing, but that's not what we're here to talk about. When we look in the Word of God, both Old and New Testament, we see prophecies that speak of things to come, particularly of that what we call eschatology, which is a study of end time or the end things. And we know prior to the Lord's return, man, I'm excited already. Prior to the Lord's return, there's some things that got to happen. And one of the things that we like to say concerning these things, surely there will be trouble in our life. And, I don't believe that believers are going to go into the tribulation. If that happens, that would mean that God is a wife beater. How are you going to marry your bride, and how we're going to be the bride of Christ, and we're going to get married, and then he's going to beat the daylights out of us. Taking us through the tribulation, that don't make sense, does it? And so but there are some things to take place, and this is what the word calls the beginning of sorrows. Amen? And y'all have heard that term lifted up before. I don't know how many of you remember, and I'm still waiting to kind of get airborne here. How many of you remember, and in 2004, there was a major 9.0 earthquake that took place in the Pacific Rim, and it affected about 14 different countries in the Pacific Rim. It was on December 26th, that the day after Christmas, right, where families that were vacationing in the South Pacific were enjoying their time early in the morning out on the beach, and because it was the day after Christmas, a lot of people were not at work, and a certain phenomena had occurred. There was a 9.0 earthquake that took place, and how many of you know that when the earthquake begins, especially if it's an underwater quake, oftentimes what it does is it causes the plates to shift. And we're going to talk about tectonic plates in a second here. But it causes the plates to shift. And when that happens, the water that's in is drawn out. And as a result of that phenomenon, other waters come up. And when that happened, many curious onlookers ran to the shore to see, because a lot of fish were displaced. In other words, the fish got thrown out, almost like they were thrown up out into the now dry soil. And so many people were running out to sea, and I would have done the same thing, I'm gonna be honest. I would have ran out to sea And I've seen something like that happen before, where I ran out and there was fish everywhere. So people were immediately grabbing the fish and placing them in, not knowing that if, when the water gets drawn out like that, what happens is eventually it's going to come back, right? Usually it usually, I hear you, Lord, break up the fallow ground, amen? Amen. That's a good sign right there. And we, even in the spirit, I say now, break up the fallow ground of our hearts so a good seed can be sown. Thank you, Father, for the rain. The times of refreshing come from being in your presence, God. So we acknowledge you and give you glory right now for the rain, God, for the season that is yet ahead, that it will bring forth good fruit in its season, amen? So when the water went out, all these people come running out to the ocean to see what was going on. Many people were sunbathing that early in the morning. And they rush out to where the ocean was. It looked like a low tide had come in. And I've been on the beach. Many of you have, when the tide was drawn out. And, you know, you're like, whoa. I was here yesterday at the beach, and the water came all the way up here to this place. Now it looked like it's half a mile out. And so many people were coming to see the phenomenon, collect, catch the fish. And when all of a sudden, 35-foot what we call tidal wave, came in and just began to slam people and throw them all over the place. It caused so much damage. It said it came in at probably a speed of 200 to 300 miles per hour. It began to remove buildings off its foundation. People were stuck in it. You know, people that thought what they were watching and thought they had time realized when they saw the 30 to 35 foot waves come in, and it was like insects being caught in a sink. Y'all follow what I'm saying? I'm gonna give you a visual representation of that once they get my video set up there. But many people were trapped and many people went to their death. I believe the last number that I heard was 230,000 people died from those 14 different countries. And when you take a closer look afterwards and you see how many people died and where they were from, we recognize also that many of them people were spiritually impoverished. There's an area in the United States, what we call the 1040 window. And in that 1040 window, it's a place from West Africa all the way through the area of India where they're spiritually impoverished. They don't worship the same God we do. And so when you begin to look at the numbers of those who died from Malaysia, Maldives, Seychelles, even 3,200 miles away in South Africa, and Tunisia, and a few other places that were affected by this tsunami, you see that the largest number of people that died were from the places that were most spiritually impoverished. God is not playing with this thing, and sometimes it causes, I think there were even some newscasters that began to, news agencies actually all over the world begin, once they got word of this great tsunami, they begin seeking out geologists, seismologists, anyone that can speak on what had taken place there, and almost overnight, tsunami had become a new word for most of the world. Meaning harbor, nami meaning waves, and so what that word means is when the waves come into the harbor, amen, and that's what happened on that day. The waves came in and caused so much destruction. It said it hit with the power of about 23,000, what do you call it, the thing that hit Hiroshima? Bombs, atomic bombs. That's the kind of power it hit with, and it. And once again, I said that was 230,000 people that had lost their life. Now, you consider USC Stadium packs about 80,000. I don't know if you've ever been in there on a football game. That's 80,000 people. Almost a small city could fit in there. We're talking 230,000 people lost their life on that day. And so we see in Scripture, as we look in Scripture, we receive warnings of that very thing is yet to come before the great and terrible day of the Lord. And so it would do us a well to pay attention what is yet to come. So that's what we're going to look at and kind of talk about today, some of these prophecies. And we see that the prophet Haggai, Isaiah, even John the Revelator, all of them mention of these things that happened. Now, When I was before you, the last time, I talked about a few things that happen when an eclipse comes in. I said before, the next eclipse occurs on 8 April, one day before my birthday. All right. I throw that out there so y'all remember, right? April 8th. April 9th is my birthday, but on April 8th, there's an eclipse to occur. Now, when there's a solar, when we say solar, we're talking about the sun. When we say solar, we're talking about what? And that's usually an omen for the world that something's going to take place in the world. When we say lunar, we're talking about the moon. And that's usually an omen for the children of Israel. That means if it occurs on a feast day, and your feast days are listed in Leviticus chapter 23, I'll get into that in a little bit if the Lord allows. But if it occurs on a feast day, so if we have a lunar eclipse and it occurs on the same day as a feast day, and we know we're approaching Passover, Easter, Pesach, whatever you want to call it. And so when these things occur during this time period, that causes us to look up and see what's going on, pay attention to see what's actually taking place. And so there's another point I was trying to get to, but sometimes there's too many things in my head going, say something about me, say something about me. But as it relates to the tsunami, let's take a look at Luke 21, and we'll begin to unpack this as we go through some of these scriptures, prophetic scriptures that talk about what's happening with the seas and the waves roaring. When you get there, say amen. Luke 21, 25 through 27. All right, that's what I'm talking about. Okay, front row, I see you. All right, so, and there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the seas and the waves roaring. Now, I don't know if you've ever been on the coastline when there's some sort of storm, but that point I was getting ready to make about what happens during an eclipse, I just got my thought back. Thank you, Holy Spirit. There are four key things that happen. Vision Hour class, where y'all at? I know y'all know. So when there's any kind of eclipse, there's usually four things that happens. Somebody from Vision Hour, anyone that knows, give me one of them. Earthquake, who said that? My bride. You don't count, baby. You do count, but you don't count for the answers. Had to clean that up, huh? So earthquake is one of them. What else? Darkness, who said that? When Jesus, yeah, that's one of my Vision Hour, yeah. Darkness occurs. Remember when Jesus, even when he says, I give you the sign of Jonah, these are some of the things that happened in that time in Nineveh. Darkness. What else? Woo, Eddie, Vision Hour class. Pestilence. He's absolutely right. And we know that even after our last great eclipse, COVID happened. Pestilence. Amen. What else? There's another one. War. So you can always count whenever there's an eclipse on those four things. Let's review and see what they are. Earthquake, darkness, pestilence. There's actually another one. Famine. Some form of famine somewhere in the world is occurring as a result. And I happen to know of some things I've been reading lately about some famines that we didn't even know about. And we'll get into that as we continue on in a little bit here. So these are some of your takeaways. One of the things I want you to know is why Indonesia, Sri Lanka, and India were the hardest hit. And remember I said the countries that are usually the furthest away from God are usually the ones that get hit. And then we're also going to find out what was the sin. And you'll see the parallels in Scripture. What was the sin that caused God's judgment? Let's just cheat right now. Somebody give me one sin that brings God's judgment. Idolatry. Boom. Okay. Y'all got it? Give me another one. Who said that? Pride. Absolutely. Give me another one. Sexual immorality. Let's call that fornication. Absolutely right. And give me another one. Rebellion, disobedience, witchcraft rebellion, kind of same along the same line. How about abortion? The taking of an innocent life. And there's a few more. When there's persecution of God's people, brings God's judgment. You know, that's why I tell folks, be careful how you handle Christian folks. Be real careful how you handle Christian folks, because there's a judgment that goes along with that. Were you not afraid that God speaks to this person face to face? Remember the conversation with God and Moses and his brother and sister Aaron? He talks to God face to face. What makes you think you can just talk back to him? Let me get back on track here, because we got a little ways to go. So your takeaways is why Indonesia, Sri Lanka, and India were hit harder than any other countries. How tsunamis are part of the fulfillment of Luke 21:25. Proof that birth pains, and when we talk about birth pains, we talk about when a woman goes into labor or travail, the closer she gets to the time of delivering her child, the more frequent and intense the birth pains are. And the earth is like a woman, and it's going through, as it gets closer to the time, it goes through its pain. Remember, the earth is reeling like, the word of God says, like a drunk man. Not only that, its weight, it remembers when men had authority in the earth. The earth remembers, so it groans and travails, waiting for men to take their rightful place and begin to command, as God said in the beginning when he said, be fruitful and multiply. Not only did he say, be fruitful and multiply, he said, have dominion. The earth remembers when Adam said, and you'll be a tree, and you're a rock, and you're this, and you're that. That's authority when you're able to call a thing and name it for what it is. So, the other thing is we're also looking at how God uses his judgment. About 20 years or so ago, I began to do this study on earth, wind, fire, water, God's judgment. I'm going to say that again. Earth, wind, fire, water, God's judgment. If you look, you can look in at least three different places in the United States alone of where you see different types of, and it sometimes brings an argument or disagreement when you say a natural catastrophe takes place somewhere in the earth and people go, these are, and I used to get mad too when they said these are acts of God, like God causes all kind of destruction. Oftentimes it's a result of sin. But when you look in California, what do you see? Wildfires. When you look in the Midwest, you see tornadoes and floods, absolutely. When you look on the East Coast where we are, you see flooding and hurricanes. Hurricanes are popular here on the East Coast. And so all these, we see these things. And I remember when Katrina came through, and somebody tell me what Katrina means. Purity, right? Purity or purification. Or some things were taking place in the earth, particularly in an area near South Florida or South Central Florida, at one of the amusement parks and some other things that were going on. Not only that, even in Louisiana, there was a judgment that was sent because I'll tell you what was happening with America. And every time, if you look at the top 10 catastrophes in the United States of America, usually it resulted as something that a head of state, somebody in the head of state, when I say head of state, I'm talking about the president, vice president, secretary, or whoever said something negative or did something negative against Israel. Remember Genesis chapter 12, right? I'll bless those that bless you, and I will curse those that curse you. I don't know why we think those are just idle words. I'm doing like this because I'm cold. Y'all know if y'all cold. I'll bless those that bless you, and I will curse those that curse you. And so every time a head of state or someone says something negative, I remember years ago, George Bush Sr. was trying to get Israel to give up land for peace deals. They were working on peace, land for peace with the Palestinians, kind of like what we're trying to do today. And so he was telling Israel that they were going to give up their land. Listen, God said, I've given this land. I bequeath this land to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob for how long? Forever. And so here we are, the United States of America, trying to give them to give up land for peace. And do y'all know what happened as a result? God called the whirlwind. When I say whirlwind, I'm talking a hurricane from West Africa, the coast. And the scriptures does tell it. He calls it from the coastline. And it travels all the way, 3,000 miles or so from the African coast to the coast, the south coast of the United States of America, goes up the coast past New York to Kennebunkport, Maine, to George Bush's house, knocks on the door, and tears his house up. Fact check me. Tore his house up. Now, we see many, many different signs like that where someone has said something negative. When the United States speaks something negative toward Israel, that happens. Well, as a result of Hillary and Bill Clinton some years ago trying to interfere in an election and kind of sway things in their way in Israel, what ended up happening is there was a land called Gush Katif. You can fact check it, Google check it, whatever you want to do. And everything that happened in Gush Katif, where they were trying to get the Hebrew, I always have difficulty saying Hebrew children of Israel, y'all know who I'm talking about, right? Israelites, modern day Israelites, trying to give them to give up land for peace and evict them out of their land, a couple of things that happened. They hated them so much, the Jews so much, what they wanted to do, they wouldn't even occupy their homes. Nice $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 homes, what they would do is they would tear their homes down or blow them up. They said all kind of negative things against the Jews. And as a result, 2 weeks later, the same things, because of Bill and Hillary's meddling in their affairs, the same thing came to our coast in the form of what we know to be Katrina. Listen, Israel's called the Fertile Crescent. New Orleans is called the Crescent City. And if you look on the map, they kind of look like they're in the same place. So everything that happened to Gush Katif in Israel happened to New Orleans. Even so much so, they didn't even want to have their gravesite, so they dug up the graves of those who were buried in Israel. And do you know that the floods that came in caused the shallow graves of New Orleans caused the graves to pop up because of the air pressure, and there were gravesites seen floating. The people who were on their housetop yelling in Israel for peace, do you know that the flood waters caused the people in Israel to come to the housetop yelling, looking for their rescuers? So the very things that we see happen there happen here. That's one of many things that I can tell you about the natural catastrophes we suffered as a result of a head of state saying something or trying to get Israel to give up their land for peace. Let me just kind of read this so I don't lose any traction here. So as I said before, and when this 9.0 in 2004 in the Pacific Rim, when it went off suddenly without warning, a violent wave inundated the entire coastline before the mothers could grab their children, and before the other beachgoers can grab their belongings, they were swept in like insects in a sink. And this tragedy was catastrophic. More than 230,000 people lost their lives. In Indonesia, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Maldives, Malaysia, Seychelles, Bangladesh, and I said before, as far as Africa and Tanzania, Kenya, South Africa, and that was 3,200 miles away. Remember, this is 2004. There was limited communication, so they couldn't really communicate the way they do now. You know how when you hear on the radio, it makes that noise and goes, "This is a test by the American Broadcast Association." Well, they were not that as updated as United States were, so there was great number of casualties, devastation, causing the worst natural disaster in their entire history. Within 24 hours, the Western world, as I said before, added tsunami to their vocabulary. Within moments of the Indian Ocean disaster, news agencies, reporters calling seismologists, scientists, and geologists to request interviews and background briefings on that particular subject. Within hours, the entire world began to hear about tsunamis and tectonic plates. So at this time, I want you to go to Matthew 24, and let's take a look at when Jesus was having his conversation and what we call the Olivet Discourse. When you get there, say amen. Give me a second to get there. What did I say it was? Amen. I got one amen. And don't y'all laugh when I put these glasses on. I'm in denial, and I'm not talking about the river either. But I warm today. Somebody said I look smart. Praise the Lord. Studious. I feel like Bishop up here with these glasses on. So once again, you know, the disciples were with Jesus, and this is what's called the Olivet Discourse, when they begin to ask him the question. And let's see where we want to start it. I can actually see this, y'all. Praise the Lord. I can see this. Baby, I can see. So, Jesus went out. I'm going to start at verse 1, and I'll go until the Holy Spirit says stop. Jesus went out and departed from the temple. Where did he go out from? And the disciples came with him, and they showed him the building of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see not that all these things, verily I say unto you, there shall not be not left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. So you can kind of imagine those who were listening in, how they began to say, he's going to tear down the temple. That's speculation or conjecture. And as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. And they said this, they said, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said to them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying that I am the Christ, and they shall deceive many. And you shall hear, watch this, wars, rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but guess what? The end ain't yet. We think it is, but it's not. The end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation. Are we seeing that now? And kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines. We talked about that. Pestilence and earthquakes in different places or diverse places. Now, what it doesn't say, it doesn't talk about the eclipse, but that's what happens. Those four things that follow after eclipse, you just read them right there. All these are the beginning of sorrows, amen. And then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but guess what? God delivers us out of some of them, out of all of them. And shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Amen. So, some of these prophecies that we're going to read about and talk about, I can't see none of them, looking at you. Some of these prophecies, we would have thought some years ago that they were kind of not really possible, but now we see in the times and the days that we're living in, they are, in fact, possible. I want to show you this clip and so that you can get an understanding. And my wife warned me, she said, don't be trying to scare nobody. I told her, I said, I'm going to scare the hell out of people, right? I ain't cussing, I'm just saying, right? I want to be scared so they don't want to go sin no more. All right, so did you all have my video set up there? And this is one that took place in, this is not the 2004, but this is in Japan, and many of y'all remember it and probably remember watching when the earthquake went off there and some of the things that happened as a result of the earthquake. This is a little bit long, but a picture's worth a thousand words, and we'll talk a little bit more from scripture so that you can see the parallel. Go ahead and run the clip. I feel like Jay Leno right there. I don't know if y'all can see that, but hopefully you can hear it. And it might be graphic, not too graphic. I didn't see anything too bad, but if you're kind of squeamish, you might want to cover your eyes. So why am I showing you this? Well, because I think it's gonna happen again. That's just me. And you need to know what to do. You need to heed the warning and know what to do. The Bible calls us to be like the sons of Issachar, to know the times and the seasons, and to know what we must do. I've watched this several times to study, what would I do? Even when I watched the San Andreas film with my wife, you know, a lot of that occurred in San Francisco, where I'm from, and I was telling her, this is a route I would take. Now, the times that we're living in now, there are cameras everywhere. And so the beauty of Big Brother is that we can see everything, both bad and good.
子宮頸がん予防ワクチン等への接種事業の財政支援。
これは1,085億円でありますけれども、また1,000億円加算をいたしているところでございます。このような対応を講じまして、現金給付と緊急地震速報です。強い揺れに警戒してください。緊急地震速報です。現地給付のバランスに努めているところ。緊急地震速報です。次の地域では強い揺れに警戒してください。
頭隠せ。終わりにしようぜ。<笑>
まだ揺れてる。
すげえ、投げ。なんだこれ。すげえ。なんだこれ。
まだ揺れてる。
やばいね。ついてきたかな。
まだ揺れてます。まだ揺れてるね。
すごいね。
飲食店です。1階部分の天井がすべて落ちています。
すごく大きな揺れがしました。壁が壊れています。この壁がすべて落ちました。
なんだひどいこれ。
まさか自分のところにこれ来ると思わなかったね。
原発やばくない？
原発やばい。
So the earthquake has already taken place, and after what, 10, 15 minutes, people are out assessing the damage.
先ほどの地震で、岩手県と宮城県、福島県に大津波警報が出ています。海岸や川の河口付近には絶対に近づかないでください。また、海岸付近の方は早く安全な高いところに避難してください。現在の気仙沼の様子です。この画面からは海面の変化、潮位の変化や津波のありなしを確認することはできませんが、早く安全な高台に避難してください。
The water has gone way down. And that's usually a result of a crack in the surface where the earthquake took place underwater, which displaces the water, and so the water goes out. But then it comes back eventually. But oftentimes, if you're not paying attention,And it's a new phenomenon. You see how the people are there, and they're just kind of watching. Now, water might be soft, but it moves fast when it's moving at a high rate of speed. In Myanmar, it was said to move at 200 miles per hour.
断続的に
So getting hit with 100 pounds more, and that's at the very low end. The impact would be devastating.
大渋滞です。今現在3時6分。まだ海面の変化はないと思われます。
Question is, did a warning go out before this?
ちょっと向こうに出たら。
You know the weather god, Doppler? Did he say anything?
Let's go. I can't get out of here. Let's go.あら、うわ、出られなくなってるわ。
Remember the word of God says, as in the days of Noah, so is it as in the end times.
こちらは青森県の八戸市の様子です。
ありますが、非常に危険ですね、これは。
はい。大津波警報、津波警報が出ていますので、どうぞ海岸や河口付近からは早く避難してください。
茶色の服の父さん、津波が来たよ。わあ！
ますから屋上に避難してください。
危ないよそば。
見てる方危険ですよ、避難してください。
You can see there the low water table.
15時13分です。結構大きな余震が来てます。
ほらそこが出たじゃん、あのあれが、そのあの海ですして、ほらジェイカの前のほら。
He's showing them the bridge now. The water's low anymore.
今この桟橋の足が見えてるってことはかなり引いてるってことですか？
見えてきてるから。見えてきてるから。
桟橋の上。
来てる？
ちょっとわからないです。
侵入してる。
ああ。今何時ですかね。人号二丸。ああ、流された。
Take this long, but I want you to get the picture of this. Houses being moved off the foundation.
その様子です。港の境を越えて水が市内の方に入り込んできています。すごい津波の力です。港の水門を越えて今水が釜石市内に流れ込んできています。釜石の市内の浜町は水浸しになっています。
As you're watching this, I want you to think about Noah after 120 years of preaching, talking about a flood and how many people, everybody ignored him. as the tsunami comes in, people just thought, well, I got time, or it's not going to affect me. I've never seen this before. I think we're about to move into an age where so many things we might see, and because we're only 160 miles off the coastline, it's quite possible we might see it ourselves. God forbid. About another 2 minutes and we'll cut it. And you can imagine all the last minute people backed up in traffic. What are you going to do when this comes in? Where are you going to go? Where are you going to run? You can see the water sweeping across the crops and everything else. Economically, there's your pestilence right there.
What happens when your crops go away?
Prices go up. You can cut that. Let's continue on. All right. So as we look through the word, we see that according to the book of Revelation, there'll be some future shakings. I want you to go right now to Revelation 16:21. When you get this, say amen. Revelation 16:21. And when we look at our judgments, we see from the time of the carrying away, and when I say carrying away, I'm talking about the rapture, when God comes to rescue those who are his, it begins the seven-year tribulation. You have the lesser tribulation, which is 3.5 years, and you have the greater tribulation, which is 3.5 years. And so from the time that we're in, and the rapture is imminent. Now, I've heard people try to argue the point that, well, Matthew 24 says, having a dumb attack for a minute. Matthew 24 says, and this gospel shall be preached unto all nations as a witness, and then the end will come. That's not necessary for new creatures in Christ. That's us. It's not necessary for us, because remember, he sends 144 witnesses, that's Jewish witnesses, and he sends the two witnesses. Amen. And that's to convert. So when we read the book of Revelation, after Revelation chapter 4, the church is gone. Don't confuse the church with Israel. Israel has to go through a tribulation process as a result of them rejecting Christ. Amen. In fact, the word tribulation comes from a farming tool called a tribulum. A tribulum is when you, that they use in the field when they're, there's two types of grain. There's the barley, which has a soft husk. It's tossed in the air, and the wind separates the chaff from the wheat. Amen? And that represents the new creatures in Christ. Our hearts are soft and pliable. The Jews, they have the hard grain, which has to be crushed. And so it goes through this wooden board that has holes in it, and it catches the grain, and it crushes it because of their stony heart. Amen? And so that's where we get the word tribulation from. Understanding that, everybody there at 16:21? Okay, let me find mine here. I can't read these words. I have to use my phone. Don't judge me. It says, and There fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent, and men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceedingly great. Remember, he said, I'll shake the heavens, I'll shake the earth. And so from the heavens, we can get many things. We can get meteors, which we know there's one out there right now floating around that says it's passed close to the earth, actually more than one. And so even with hail, about the size of a talent, that's about 110, 130 pounds. Can you imagine you walking around after the rapture's come and you get hit in the head by a 110-pound rock coming from space? That ain't going to be no good. It ain't going to be good to be left behind. Amen? Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 31, verse 16. Get this, amen. That's Ezekiel chapter 31. Let's start off at verse 16 there. We're almost done. Wait for the main man's. Okay. It says, I made the nations to shake at the sound of his fall, and when I cast him down to hell, with them that descend into the pit, and all the trees of Eden, the choice and the best of Lebanon, all that drink water shall be comforted in the nether parts of the earth. Let me say this about the judgments. After Revelation chapter 4, there are how many judgments? Vision hour? Okay, I'm asking again. How many judgments? At least 21, right? They come in groups of seven. Remember the first one of the seal judgments, right? First seal being the white horse, second seal, red horse, then the pale, and then the black horse, and then the woes, right? And then comes what after the seal judgments? Trumpet judgments, right? It's in the Word. It's open book. You can look in your Bible. Comes the seven trumpet judgments. Then what comes after the trumpet judgments? The bowl or the vial judgments, right? So we see a total of 21 different types of judgments, and they get progressively worse and worse and worse and worse. You don't want to be here for any of those judgments. That's why when the horn blows, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and where it talks about we are alive and remain, we will be preceded by those who have already passed on, and we'll be caught up in the air to meet them there. But then we get to go home. We get our new bodies. In the Greek, that new body is called okaterion. We get a new body, a new heavenly body, and we are up in heaven getting our rewards and protection. We follow a Hebrew pattern of a marriage, and I've shared that with you before about, you know, we are the bride of Christ. The Hebrew nation is the wife of God, but we are the bride of Christ. And so we'll be in the bridal chamber for a period of 7 years, and then we will come out with Christ adorned in our white robes, according to Revelation 19:8. White represents the righteousness of the saints. But something peculiar in the passage talks about Jesus' robe won't be white. It'll be dipped in blood. And so even though we're going to come riding on white horses with him, guess what? We don't look like we're going to be fighting. It says his blood, his robe is dipped in white, not ours. So he does all the fighting. Amen. Go ahead and turn to, let's look at what Haggai has to say about that. Turn to Haggai, some people say Haji, 2:7. Haggai 2:7. When you get there, say amen. That was quick. And it says this, and I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and silver represents atonement, And gold is mine, gold represents his deity, saith the Lord. The glory of the latter house shall be greater than that of the former. I want to take you to another passage of scripture. If you would go to Isaiah 24, and this will be our last one for this evening. I didn't cover half the ground I thought I was going to cover. It's okay, though. Once again, that's Isaiah 24, 19. I must be boring, y'all. I ain't getting no amen. Don't say it now. Y'all like the people got caught in the flood. All right, so and it reads, and the earth is utterly broken down. The earth is clean dissolved. The earth is moved exceedingly. Get this part. And you, I want you to think about the earthquake when you hear this. The earth shall reel and fro like a drunkard. And we saw that in the video. And shall be removed like a cottage. You saw how those all fall. I remember my wife and I were in Tahoe one time, and we were on our way up to Lake Tahoe, and we saw a mudslide had happened, and brand new homes hadn't even been lived in were in a river. And we're like, that's strange that we see them in the river like that. But the power of the earth and God to shake it is something else. I'm on verse 20. The earth shall reel and fro like a drunkard, and shall be removed like a cottage, and the transgressors thereof shall be heavy upon it, and shall fall and not rise again. And you saw many of them buildings, and many times when destruction comes in, it can cause some destruction. It's kind of hard to put that thing back. And it shall come to pass that in that day that the Lord shall punish the host of the high ones that are on high, and the kings of the earth upon the earth, and they shall be gathered together as prisoners are gathered in the pit, and they shall be shut up in the prison, and after many days they shall be visited. Then the moon shall be confounded, and the sun ashamed, when the Lord of hosts shall reign in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before the ancients gloriously. I wish I had time to unpack that, but our time has come to a close. But the big picture and the big takeaway is understanding that the prophecies of old have spoken, and the Lord has said, I will shake the heavens, I will shake the earth, I will shake the dry land, and I will shake the sea. And you can see in the heavens, you just can imagine, when the heavens are shaken, what do you see? You see the stars, you see meteors falling from the sky, you see the hail as we spoke of. How about on the land, what do you see? The earthquakes and the cracking and the fissures that occur in the earth. How about the sea? You see hurricanes roaring. And so it's easy for us in this day and time, you know, the prophets, we could have thought that was just the rantings of old men. But today, in this time that we live in now, and I remember many people saying, I wish that I could live in the Bible days. Let me tell you now, you're living in the Bible days, amen. This is the greatest time that we're living in, because we're able to see those things which were spoken of old. We're seeing them happen right here and right now. And so the question is, what type of men and women should we be? What should we be pressing toward? Toward that mark, toward the prize of the high calling that's in Christ Jesus, that we should be living our lives intentionally to be what he's calling us to be, that when he comes, he find us without spot, without blemish. Because guess what? There's a judgment coming. We've already read. We know what the judgment is. And so we need to be prepared that when the horn blows, we got to go. Come on, give God a hand praise. Right? Oh, you can circle up. Y'all can circle up. Moving kind of slow. I know y'all want to get out of here. Cricket, cricket. So, I don't feel a strong appeal for salvation, but I'm going to ask, if you want to escape the coming night, you can make a decision for Christ today by raising your hand right where you are. We'll have some representatives come and pray with you and lead you in a sinner's prayer. But if that's not you, but you want to become a member of Word of God Church and Ministries, which, as Pastor John would say, I think is one of the best churches in the world. I'm not even from here. I'm from Cali. But the, you know what's keeping me here? Word of God Church and Ministries and my church family. I love y'all and I mean it, as Erica Whatchamacallit would say. I love y'all and I mean it. I ain't going nowhere till the Lord say so. Amen. So, as the offering's coming around, if you want to make your offering, and those of you watching by live stream and television, you can go to your phone and type in 77977 on push pay and return the tithe and give your offering there. I believe we're in a time and a season as we approach some holy days where we give our best gifts, so our best offering, pay our best prayers. And God will bless you exceedingly abundant above all that you can ask or even think, according to the power that works in you. And so we want to remember that as we approach this Passover. Remember the blood. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. And we recognize and we honor this. This is what I call the real Memorial Day. We'll remember what Christ done for us. I think if had they known what the blood had done, they would have never crucified him. They would have never crucified him. We thank God for the blood. I even plead the blood as we're preparing to make our way out of here over each and every one of you. For those of you that press your way out, despite the weather, despite the rain, we bless God for you making your way out. And I pray that he would increase everything in your household. Even when you return to your household, you will find things blessed and in order. Amen. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for those that gave, Lord God. We thank you that you give seed to the sower, Lord God. We thank you for our bishop in his absence and our first lady, Lord God, and our first family. We thank you for the word, Lord God, even though it seemed kind of dry to me, Lord God. I pray that you reach the heart of your people, that the warning, even the clarion call has gone out, Lord God, that even as the sons of Issachar, Lord God, we will know what the times and the seasons are and know what to do, Father. No, we thank you, Lord God. We pray that you would marinate it in our hearts. Write your word upon the table of our hearts that we don't sin against you, Lord God. We pray safety and travel as we prepare to leave this place, but not your presence, Lord God. Father, give us traveling mercies top to bottom, bumper to bumper, Lord God. May your people be blessed as they have sacrificed their time. We know you to be Jehovah Gamola, the complete and changeless God of recompense. And then for their time, Father, that you would recompense their time. Father, we love you and we thank you. We look forward with eager expectation to come back on Sunday, Lord God, that we may bless you, Lord God, and lift your name up. Father, we thank you. We give you all the glory and the honor in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Amen. Give God a hand, praise, and hug somebody on your way out.